you is first, I will show you an introduction, a very high-level overview, what is NoSQL, and then I want to show you some basic concepts about NoSQL, which are important there in this area. And afterwards, Volker will present you some concrete NoSQL databases that you can use in different areas. So first, the history of NoSQL. For decades, of course, SQL databases were very dominant because they offer a lot of advantages. Of course, everyone knows they have provide persistent storage, they are based on standards, they have concurrency control, they provide application integration. You can connect to an application for a central database and every application can talk to each other. And they, of course, have the ACID support. But they are designed to run as a virtual or logical single big machine in a central way that every application knows where they can access it. Otherwise, but now, in last years or last decade, the cloud computing comes up and changes that dramatically, because in cloud computing you have normally a big cluster of machines, you have a large amount of these unreliable cheap machines that you add always, all the time. If you have to scale, you add thousands of unreliable machines which will break soon again, but this should be no problem. And because of that, you have everywhere now distributed systems. And furthermore, you add always more data, and the data should be schema-free or unstructured, because you can't predict what data will come tomorrow. So, and it's also big data, a lot of data you have to store. And so now we can think about how can we run our database in the cloud, because this we need the scalability and all the features of the cloud. Of course, there are a lot of possibilities how you can do it. The first you think about, if you think about, is of course you take a virtual image at Amazon, you look up, is there an Amazon image, for example for Oracle, yeah, there is one, so you can start it, you have an Oracle database. So you can purchase the image, or you can upload your old image and start it. But then you have problems with scalability, of course, because then you have to think about everything yourself. Then on the next level, you can, of course, also take database as a service. There you can go to any provider, you can book your database as a service, you get directly the JDBC URL, for example, and you can access your database. And then the scalability is managed for you. But of course, this has also limitations. You cannot scale endlessly there. There's always, you have to look up how much can you scale and how much does it cost in this case. But you don't have to configure it yourself and you don't have to do it yourself. And then there's for big customers or for special customers, of course, you can have a managed database hosting where you can say, I want to have, for example, at Rackspace, you can book a managed hosting of MySQL, where you can, and then the MySQL database is managed completely for you, and everything is done for you like you wish. But this is a service, so it's not really automatic. And of course, the best way, which when you got invented partly, is the Tosca way. There you can model your complete application, you can model your application stack, you can model your database stack, and then you can provide it automatically using an engine, and then you can scale also your database like how you want at any time you want, because you can do management in this Tosca descriptions, and then you have a portable and interoperable definition of the database setup, of its security requirements, of its compliance aspects, which is also very important in data management. And this way you have a nice method to run your database in the cloud. And then, of course, you have to think about which data model do I need, because this is not trivial too. If you, of course, everyone knows the relational databases. If you choose this one, you have a standard which you are based on. This is always very good. But it's not cloud ready. It's difficult to scale normally, of course. And so, if you take NoSQL databases, on the other hand, they were designed for the cloud, so they are thought for scaling, and they are built for heavy read and write loads, and they have good ability to scale up and down. But they are But if you have an application already that you want to use and it is built for SQL databases, it's difficult to use NoSQL databases because you have to rewrite your application and this is not very nice. So it depends on a lot of factors what you can use and what you should use. And what scaling means? Scaling in this area means if you have vertical scaling, for example, in the SQL database, you have to scale up your databases. That means you have to have a bigger machine or more machines connected to each other, and they are seen as one big machine, and you have to manage this. Or if you have horizontal scaling, like in a cloud environment, you can scale out. That means you add more and more small machines, and by that you scale. And this is a distributed scaling, and it's more complicated. And you can see here, why do you need it? And the business data normally is not growing so fast, and the web data, but is growing exponentially. So in the web data area, you need something like this. In the business transaction data, where it's important to have secure and asset transactions, then you would rather use a SQL database, of course. So it depends on many factors what you should use. And normally NoSQL is only needed if you have a lot of data which is growing all the time very fast and like this. So now let's come to the definition and the goals of NoSQL database. There is no formal definition, I have to say first. The NoSQL only means not only SQL for the most people. So that means you don't see only SQL databases if you're thinking about your database, you also look at other databases if they fit to your problem. Or for some people it means the database does not support SQL, so no SQL directly. So you can choose what you want. And they are there for storing, like I said, very large scale big data, which you can also see here in this example. If you can read it, it's a little bit small, but you see here the years and how much is the data growing all the years in every area. And it's really growing a lot. For example, the YouTube videos, 120 hours per minute. 1 year, 2 years before, it was 72 hours. So and this is all to be stored anywhere. And so you need horizontal scaling, but they only provide a simple query mechanism normally. This is no SQL database, so no advanced SQL queries or anything. And they often are set up for a concrete application and only for one application type. For example, for posting Twitter or something, you set up a NoSQL system and then it fits perfectly to it and you implement it merely for the application and not other way around. You have a standard database and use it for any application. And typical heuristics I will show you now of NoSQL database ones, they are non-relational, schema-free, open source normally, provided as open source software. They have a simple API, they are distributed, and they provide only eventual consistency. What does that mean? Non-relational means NoSQL databases do not follow the relational model. They do not provide tables with fixed flat column records. They work with aggregates instead, so they have aggregates or blobs to manage. And the advantage is you don't need the object relational mapping and the data normalization of because you can directly put in the data in the database. And but you have also a drawback there that you don't can use the costly and complex functions. You don't have to implement them in the database, but you can't use them. You have to implement them in your code then of your application, for example. Query languages, query planners, referential integrity. That means if you have different objects in your system and they depend on each other, your application has to manage that. And earlier, in SQL databases, this is managed for you, and if the integrity is broken, you get an error. And joins are not supported, and of course, the transactions also are not supported. Then schema-free does mean the most NoSQL databases have no schema definition, or they have a relaxed schema definition. Then you don't have to define it in advance, the schema. You can start directly using it. And this allows heterogeneous structures of data in the same domain. So you can put any data you want. But then the application, on the other hand, has to know what data is it, and what is inside, and if they query, the application queries it. it has to work with it without any knowledge about the structure. Then the databases provide a simple API, only for querying and for storing the data, and they only allow low-level manipulation and selection, and they are not standards-based, and they only have a text protocol normally, like JSON, and you call it by REST functions. And but advantages is you are web-enabled, that means they always or mostly have a web interface where you directly, as a user, can test your queries and ask use the database directly. You don't have to go to a command line or something. SQL databases. Then a distribution. The most SQL databases can be executed in a distributed fashion and provide overscaling or failover capabilities, but as a sacrifice for scalability and throughput, and no synchronous replication is provided, only asynchronous. That means you can have stale data, different data in different areas of your database, so you only have virtual consistency. And there are, of course, many, many types of NoSQL databases, but there are four types which are a little bit more dominant than the others. And these are the key value stores, the most easy NoSQL database where you have a key, and with the key you can store any value and you can get back your value all the time if you give the database the key. And it's a big hash table, and it manages the associative arrays. And then the other by column stores, which we heard a talk yesterday already. It's very nice examples there. In the by column stores, you can have more columns than normally in your database, like you see here. And it's managed column based, so it's more performant. Yeah. And then the next ones are the document stores. And for each of them, Holger will present you one example database later in more detail. The document stores, they store documents like here in JSON or BSON or XML, anything. And you can directly put the document there, schema free, and it's stored for you. And the graph database store graphs, and we have, of course, nodes, which are entities, and they can have properties for name or something like an address. And then you can have relations between this, and the relations can also have properties, and you store this directly, so you can make something like a social network very easily, store it very easily, and you can also make very easy analysis of the relations between the entities. So, and so you see everything has a different area where you can apply it. And some examples where uses or implements databases, NoSQL databases. Google, of course, invented a lot of NoSQL databases they use for their search and for their apps of the two, but you can also use NoSQL database there and use it for your own. And Facebook uses, of course, NoSQL databases. Twitter uses NoSQL databases. Amazon provides it if you want to use it in NoSQL database hosted by them. I can provide it for you. The CERN uses NoSQL database to integrate all their different systems they have and to share the data they collect between researchers. And you also can see a source code tool like GitHub, where you manage the source code around the world with all the others. It's also like a NoSQL database where you can make the updates and you can get your code. So let's have a look on the basic concepts now you need for NoSQL. The first important thing is the CAPTCHA ring here, the Brewer's tree ring, which states you can only have two of three guarantees. The three guarantees are the consistency, that means all nodes see the same data at the same time if you have this distributed database. And so availability is the second guarantee. Every request receives a response, whether it succeeded or failed, and it should of course correct the response. And then you have the partition tolerance. The system continues to operate despite the physical partitions. That is important. If the network between the database is broken, then you can't reach the other databases. So if you make an update on one area of this partition, the other area doesn't see it. And if you make a read request on the other area, you don't get the same data as in the first partition. And this is
a big problem in distributed systems. So you have to choose what you want. And the SQL databases are typically, of course, consistent and available. But if you have partitions, you can't make queries on the partition area. So it has no connection to the master. And in NoSQL area, it's typically here, because this is the cloud computing area, also the name service is here. If a cloud computing system, because here the partition tolerance must be high in the availability, but you sacrifice then, of course, the consistency. And you don't have the full consistency, you only have eventual consistency. That means the copies of on multiple machines, you have copies of the data on multiple machines in the distributed system to achieve this high availability and scalability, but the change in one data in a data item on one machine has to be replicated, of course, to all others. And the propagation is not instantaneously, and so the copies are mutually inconsistent. And the change will be propagated anytime, but it's not directly there. And this means if you achieve this eventual consistency, is achieved if every replica has this copy then. And this you call achieved replica convergence, and then it's again consistent. But this is not always the case, so you can also get old data if you make a query. And this is called base, in contrast to the ACID printing, basically available and soft state and eventual consistency. Yes, and the next basic concept we need for distributing the data around the servers is the consistent hashing. This technique is there for distributing the data on the replicas, because you have to think about how to distribute it, that it is highly available, that the data is not lost if one server breaks, and that it is good to distribute it. So it works like this. You have a hash function, which is not has a special kind of hash function. When you create a new hash, you don't have to remap all the other hash functions. So it's like a ring here, you start with zero and until the end of the hash function, and then you insert all the servers, and their hash are based on their name or IP or anything, and you put the servers here. And if you insert a new server, then you take this hash of this server, and the others just don't change, and you add this server in the hash ring, and then all the objects belong to the server next in the ring. So it changed from this server to this server, this object here, and you can find them very fast, and they know where they belong to which server, where they have to be stored. And if you delete a server, of course, this server, then it would go again to this server, the data. And of course, you can also have virtual servers. That means this is only one server, but it's two times here, so the distribution is better of the servers. And you can also have the objects multiple times, so you have redundancy, and you can distribute them very good in the ring, and then they are on different servers stored, and so on. And you don't lose anything if a server goes away or a new comes in. And the next thing we need for managing then the updates on this distributed system is the multi-version concurrency control. It's a concurrency control method to provide concurrent access to the database. In SQL databases, normally you use locking, or in earlier times, where you have a transaction of one user, and the user can write, and the other user here, he has to wait until the transaction is finished, and then he can read. So this is delayed, and this is not good, because it's not fast, and not directly response of the database. So in MVCC, you do the same here, the same transaction, the user writes, and in this case, always a new version is added. So here you only have one version, B, and here you have a version B1, and so the user writes and gets a new version, and the user 2 can read the old version all the time, the B0. And after the transaction, it's the new version is returned. So all the time you can read. So this is very important that you can, it's fast. And of course, there can conflicts occur, like B1A, B1B, but this can be managed by the database then, or it also can be managed by the user. You can, for example, couch it is those both versions, and then you have to fix it as user anytime if you want, or you can leave both if you want. Yeah, but also a database can manage the conflicts, of course, that is itself. Then we have now stored the data in the database, but how do we get it back? For that we need query mechanisms, and in NoSQL, of course, you have the REST functions to retrieve the data based on the key. If you have the key already, you get it very fast back. You can all the time ask for it. Then you can, of course, make views. For example, in CouchDB, you can define views using MapReduce functions. Then you have always views that are updated with each object which comes in. Then you have always a view for looking up special data you want. So you have always running query which builds the views. And MapReduce is available in most NoSQL databases and can be run distributed. This is the advantage. So you can run it on also distributed like a database, and it's functional programming, it's not writing queries, so it's different. And it has a map phase, it has many phases, but the most important one is the map phase, performing the filtering and sorting, and the reduce phase. It's a very funny similar example here. You have the food, and the map phase cuts all the things in little pieces, and then you have the reduce phase, and it puts it together to a sandwich, each piece together. And then, and so you can compare it to a select and group by a relational database, but we'll see later more about that. And Apache Spark is the open source framework, which has even more functions for MapReduce definitions. And for example, use cases for MapReduce are, of course, distributed search, or counting of anything, of URLs, of words and text, or something, and building linkage graph of websites, or those sort of distributed data, something. Now we will come to the overview of the NoSQL systems by Holger, and we see each area in NoSQL database and examples.
So, good morning, everyone. As Matthias said, the idea of the second part is to go through this four major groups of NoSQL systems again and look at one example for each of them. And I try to focus on some interesting aspects of each of the systems. I must say that there are a couple of systems that are not clearly identified as members of one of these classes. And also, I would not claim that the example we picked here is somehow representative of this entire class, but at least I think we picked some very popular examples for each of these type of NoSQL systems. So let's start with this very basic approach, the key value stores. Here are some names from this area. So what I will focus on is on RIAC, a system that is around for several years now and available for various platforms, and there are quite a number of libraries to use for connecting to this system. So before we look into some aspects of React, what are typical use case scenarios we can think of for this type of key value stores? So if we have something like session data with the session ID and some information associated with. If we have user profiles, also identified by ID and some perhaps more information that comes with these user profiles. These are typical examples. They are typically because we mainly access the data by means of the key here. Another example just to demonstrate that not only keys consisting of a single value are relevant here. We could also think of keys that are combined information from timestamps and location-based information, for example, produced by some sensors. This could also be an example. So we are talking about this kind of data, this kind of applications. Now, how is that organized in Rhino? First, in terms of the structure we have, of course, we have this key value data to store, and in Rhino they are organized in so called buckets. Are not just a collection of key-value pairs, they also are associated with the important properties for this group of key-value pairs. And over time, people found out that associating these properties to the buckets again and again is somehow cumbersome, and that's why this additional layer was brought in here, so-called bucket types. They just group the patterns of these properties for buckets, and then it's more easy to associate a certain combination of properties with a new bucket that is brought into the system. Now, of course, as you can see on the right side, we have all the functions to organize all these things. For key value store, there are three main operations that we can assume. Of course, we want to store new key-value pairs, and of course, we want to get the information. And the only option to get access to the data is to use the key and retrieve the corresponding value that is stored in the system. And of course, we later on want to delete this information. So this is the main functionality, without any details about syntax for the various drivers you can use, but this characterizes the basic functionality you can expect from such a system. So now, Matthias mentioned various of the basic concepts. So how does that look like for Dryad? Of course, it addresses potentially large clusters, and each node in this cluster runs a separate instance of the system, and then we have to map some of the data to one of these so-called V nodes, the virtual nodes, and of course this is done by mapping to map the data to one of these partitions, and then the nodes are associated with these partitions and by these hashes that we know where to find the data for a specific key, and that's the main information we need to access the data again. So we want to have a high availability of the system. We of course go for replication in Rhino as well. There is a replication factor that can be set, and then just by this hash function we have a sequence of partitions where the data is mapped to, and that corresponds to the node where we could find the data. If one of them is not available, we can check for the next one. So these bucket parameters I mentioned include this replication factor, and they include this other information, how many servers have to respond for a successful read, how many have to respond for a successful write operation. The full write operation, we can also specify that the write operation must be successful applied to data on this. So these are, I would say, the major examples of parameters we have to configure these aspects. And of course, the combinations of these values influences availability as well as consistency, and in the end it has its influence on the performance of the overall system. So now I mentioned consistency, and perhaps we can talk about transactions in the same context. So there are no notion of multi-operation transactions in this system, which is typical, as Matthias already mentioned. The default here is that we have exactly this eventual consistency behavior that was already explained. So we need some means to resolve conflicts of the data. Vector clocks and dot recursion vectors are used in the system. Anyway, since the version 2.0, RIAC also supports strong consistency notion. Here you define a column of nodes that need to respond for successful operations, and so this gives you more consistency guarantees as in the and standard usage. So we have this basic operations in mind. We've just the value for a specific key. It's obvious depending on your application. You may want to do more. You may want to somehow query this value, which is just some kind of long string block information for a system like RIAC, and that's why there is also a component available called RIAC Search. So this tries to support a kind of other query functionality, some kind of text search on this value information. That's why it's based on a search platform that goes back to Apache Lucene functionality. So what you have to do is to describe some kind of extractors. So how can we identify separate fields in this value part of our data? And this information, these fields, can then be indexed, and we can use this index to come up with more detailed queries, some kind of exact match queries, range queries on these values, something that you have to do in your application if you're using the system as it was originally designed. So even if this simple key value stores, people found out that bringing more functionality from the peer side would be interesting, and this somehow leads us to the next category of those NoSQL systems. So if we want to talk about the internal structure, if internal structure is more important for the application, perhaps the document stores are better suited, at least for some application areas. So here again, some of the famous names in this area. What I will focus on is MongoDB. Again, available on various platforms. We have made multiple ways to access the data from any kind of programming language. So first of all, if we talk about documents, Matthias already had a small example. Here two more examples. So in this context documents, something like those JSON documents, here information for certain people, and you can easily identify that it is not exactly the same information, not exactly the same structure that is described here. So this is exactly one important point here. We have no fixed schema, we have flexibility in terms of the data we want to bring into this document. So JSON is very important in the context of document stores. Typical use cases for such a system. So we could think of some kind of simple content management. For example, information from blogs and forums could be interesting here. We could think of the need to cover logging event information from heterogeneous system landscape. So that is logging information is somehow flexible and heterogeneous, and there is no fixed schema to identify. And also the same holds for parts or aspects of e-commerce systems, where we might look for a flexible way to describe products or order information. So now, how is the data organized in MongoDB? We simply have collections of this kind of objects here, and they are on the next level organized in so-called databases. So, an obvious way to organize these things. How about the key functions that are available besides organizing these collections? We have statements to explicitly define index. So if we know about the application, which fields are most important here, we can define the appropriate index structures and use them for the queries. And from the data selection and data manipulation side, the main operation is the so-called find operation, but in comparison to the key value stores, we not just focus on the key here, we also can describe selections on various parts of this document. So, and of course, we have standard insert, update, delete. Here's an example for such a find query, and typical examples in terms of the two steps that are important here. So we have the search or the filter criteria as one major query step, and then we have a so-called modifier step, which is in this case used to order to sort the outcome of the intermediate step here. So that's the major aspects of viewing the data. How about availability in MongoDB? Of course, we have replication again here. The notion that is used in MongoDB is so-called replication sets. So we have a primary, and we apply the operations log from this primary to the secondary secondaries in the system, and thereby we have replicated information, and we can select a new primary in case the original primary goes down. So here are some specific secondaries mentioned. There are some reasons why a secondary should never become primary. These are the so-called priority zero members. There are some hidden members that could be used for specific applications patterns only, and there are also so-called arbiters that just are involved when a new primary has to be defined, but do not respond to the queries there while the system is used in the normal mode. So replica sets are important here, of course. We could also build on this replica sets for improving read scalability here, but then eventual consistency is important, so we may read stale data from one of these secondaries. about scalability with the focus on the write operations. Concept of sharding is important in MongoDB. So we can split up the data sharding on the collection level here by using one of the indexed fields from our checks and documents. The sharding can be done either range-based or hash-based, and in the end each of these shards is a separate instance of MongoDB. There are background processes that care about the even distribution of the data here, and what is not shown here, the sharding spreadsheet can also be combined with the replica set of watch. So if we look, think about consistency aspects, again, one major parameter in MongoDB to adjust it to your needs is the so-called write concern. Default is a successful operation on the primary is sufficient. Nothing else has to be done. We can define the number of nodes to which the operation should successfully be propagated, and we can also explicitly ask for a majority of the available voting nodes to be moved here to come up with the result. Another option that we can use here is the so-called read preference. So the default is that we route all the requests for data to the primary. But there is also the option to route the requests to one of the secondaries. Of course, if you read from secondaries, it may, the data may be stale. Interesting enough here that even if we just read from the primary, we could get stale data, because there are certain situations in the systems where two primaries seem to exist. So that's true if a new primary has been enacted. There might be still the old one in the system answering, responding to read requests, and there might also be a new one, and this may lead to situations where we get stale data. So we have to be careful about that, even if we just use the primaries for reading data. And again, there is no such thing like multi-operation transactions support in MongoDB as well. So next in row are white column stores, also called column family stores. Both terms are somehow equivalent here. The example system I will use here is HBase, which exists as an Apache project for quite a while now, and which builds on HDFS as the underlying distributed file system, and in the end, main aspects of Bigtable table are implemented in HBase. So yesterday we already have seen a nice example of the logical structure behind such a system. So here is a more simple one. The basic aspects are that we have the row keys again to identify our objects in the data. They can be associated with timestamps, and then we have these column families, which have to be defined at design time, but at runtime we are then flexible to add any column to the specific column family as it is needed for the application. Same flexibility as we have in document stores with the specific structure of the document. And as you can imagine, if we define these columns flexibly, as one can see only also in this example, This results in a quite sparse table, and of course the metadata for such a system can just cover the column families and not the individual columns themselves. So on the physical organization layer, it looks more like this. So we have only those values to store that are present in the system, and the basic mapping is done on a key value level and with an internal structure for the key that represents the column families and more detailed information. So if we try to organize that in this abstract picture again, so what is important here, so we have tables with these column families, they are organized in namespaces, and for getting access to the data, we can use a combination of the key of these rows with the timestamp, of course, write the data, there is a scan operation available, and of course, we delete the data as well. So here, the data is organized in so-called regions. This is the term for sharding in HSpace. And these regions are managed by so-called region servers. And of course, to organize the overall request processing, we also have the corresponding master server called HMaster here, and to have no single point of failure, there are also backup servers available for this one. And as you can see at the bottom, there are the corresponding failover strategies available for each of these components. Let's have a look at some more details of the internal organization of the data. So here we assume that we have one table T with two of these column families defined. And as I said, they are split up in the various regions, and they are so-called stores to cover the data. Each store covers data from one of these column families. And in the structure, we can easily identify how modifying and reading the data works. So to read the data, we system first writes all changes to a log. It then updates the in-memory structure, which is the so-called map store here, and finally, from time to time, all the changes are flushed to files which are the so-called store files in HSpace. Reading the data, here we have to consider that the most current information could be either in a so-called block hash, which is not explicitly shown in this picture here. It could be in the memory structure, a memstore, or it could be already written to one of the store files. So in the end, we have to, the system has to go to all these three parts of the overall data store to get the current version. So you can imagine if this goes on and many updates happen, we need some reorganization, so I will skip that now. If we talk about transactional and consistency aspects here, again, one more example of system without no explicit transaction boundaries. We have some atomicity on the row level here, and here, in contrast, the first assumption is that we route all the operations through a single region server, which would give us a strong consistency guarantees, but there are also options that more focus on high availability. So one final remark on this category and a single slide on Cassandra, another system from this category, just to show you that there are also systems available that provide a specific SQL-like query language that could be used. But now let's focus on the fourth category we mentioned in the beginning, graph stores or graph databases. The most prominent one and the one I will focus on is Neo4j. From Neo Technologies, also almost 10 years old now. So if we ask about the typical use cases again, they are quite obvious for this kind of data store. Of course, if we have highly connected data like in social networks, if this data contains some kind of location or distance information, this is naturally represented as a network, and based on that, we even could build recommender systems. For example, if we have data what people visited as tourists. So what is the data model that is underlying typical graph databases? It's the property graph model. So of course we have nodes and edges. The important thing here are the properties that we can associate with nodes as well as with edges, and to add interesting information to this network of data. So in the end, there is just the collection of nodes and edges and their properties as the graph structure that has to be covered by the system, with all the statements to manage this information. The query part is a bit more flexible than for the other statements. We have simple queries that provide some patterns that have to be matched in data. We have a typically function available to travel or traverse the graph, and there are also options to build indexes, to ask the system to define indexes on the node and edge structures and use them for querying. Neo4j is an example of such a system that uses declarative query language, Cypher. There are other examples of these languages available. Here is a very simple example of those statements for such a map query. So we create some nodes, create some edges, and then we find out in such a graph by the social network Boom. So let me come back to scalability aspects again. Now in Neo4j, for read scaling, of course there would be the option to just use a large enough memory to keep the active part of the graph in memory. We can add so-called read-only slaves in Neo4j, so that at least for some parts of the graph that are focused on by specific applications, this part of the graph fits into memory. And finally, if you ask for sharding here, so this is not directly supported by the system. If you want that, you have to do that on your own. So it's application level sharding that you have only. There is also a high availability feature in Neo4j. So we have the option to have master and slaves, as they are called here again. So the operation, the write operations are committed as soon as they are successful on the master and then propagated to the slaves. And for writing on the slave, this picture shows that the change is directly propagated to the master, and as soon as it is committed on the master again, it is committed towards the application. And of course, it should be propagated to the other slaves as well, but there is also the option to pull for the last modifications asynchronously controlled by the various slaves. Again, we have eventual consistency in this system. There is one point, perhaps worth mentioning, in contrast to all the other systems I have shown you. Neo4j explicitly supports something like transaction boundaries, so you can tie various operations together in some kind of transaction. So, as I'm running out of time, Matthias already mentioned processing data in the NoSQL context could mean we use the query capabilities or the query language that those systems provide to you, but also using a MapReduce framework, Hadoop, would be a typical or obvious choice, at least for some of the applications. In the end, we have this map and this reduce space. Here, this example, we assume we have some employee data. We split it up in department and salary combinations, key value pairs, and the reduce phase would aggregate that. Hadoop MapReduce provides the framework to execute this kind of jobs in a distributed fashion, control the failures of the various nodes, restart jobs, and the underlying HDFS cares about the replication of the data, so that we really have fault tolerance in this kind of system. So let's keep it that for Hadoop MapReduce. So we look at the landscape, Hadoop landscape. So is that all we have available? We can easily identify other systems that focus on other aspects for improving the processing in Hadoop and OSQL context. So let me mention just two categories. First, there are examples of systems that build a layer on top of this MapReduce processing. Hive and Pig are famous examples for that. So they provide some SQL interface to the data that is in the end stored in HDFS, for example, and SQL in this case is mapped to MapReduce jobs. Others identified that if we do this MapReduce job processing, for each intermediate step, we have to write the outcome to some files. So this results in very high latency in the end. So other systems more focus on this kind of data stream processing and try to do as much processing in memory as possible. So Sprog and Flink are examples from this category. And in the end, there are many more topics we skipped for this introductory part. There are other types of NoSQL system. What I did not mention is there are also new SQL systems, and there are also all kinds of cloud offerings providing the capabilities that I try to describe in their basics. So in the end, we have NoSQL systems as a heterogeneous group of alternatives for data management compared to traditional data, relational database management, and a few major aspects you have to carefully look at in your application to make the right decision for your application is always the most appropriate data model that you have. You have to look at the query complexity that you expect to be supported by the system. You have to look at the consistency needs and also other transactional requirements, and then you can make a more logical decision in this rather heterogeneous world of data management. So that's all what I have prepared. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Holger. Thank you, Matthias. Other questions? I wanted a few. I knew that you started.
The previous chart had new SQL. Yeah? New SQL. Like topics we skipped. Can you spend a minute on new SQL?
New SQL is associated with systems like Google Spanner. There is a system Google F1 where they try to support SQL in the system and also support the guarantees that we need to do, for example, OLTP processing on such systems, but in a highly distributed fashion as it is developed for the NoSQL systems over the years. So that's the basic idea, but that would be a topic on its own, I would say.
Any further questions?
How is it about simple performance and comparison between SQL databases and NoSQL databases? Let's say for some simple queries, or let's say for some queries along the tree, if you didn't mention it, has it been somehow the same performance using SQL or using NoSQL? Or how is it about transactions? Simple inserts or simple deletes or alt loading maybe? Are there differences in this respect?
Yeah, I would say it's hard to make a general statement about that. So we did experiments with graph structures at the institute, comparing it with kind of relational mapping, comparing it with Neo4j exactly. And so typical graph traversals are much more efficient in this specific system. So this is one experience we really have where it is worth to use this specialized system. And you know, I would dare to make a more general statement.
There's no benchmark, so you can't compare it. So my claim basically is I'm old enough to remember all the old database discussions. This NoSQL stuff will disappear in 10 years. What would be your reaction? I'm absolutely sure.
It will be integrated. If it's a good feature, it will be maybe integrated. Yes, but databases.
This is your interpretation too? What's happening?
It's already happening.
Huh?
It's already happening. Postgres now has, Postgres SQL has no SQL features.
Yes. Any further questions? Tim?
When you have a database that doesn't enforce a schema, I think you're pretty much. You have to enforce the schema yourself in your application logic. What do you think are the the dangers maybe of doing something like this? Because when you consider making new versions of an application and you change something in your data schema, other parts of the application might not be able to read the data anymore, something like this. Is there a danger of using these systems? Or how is this handled usually?
Yeah, in the end, it's handled by your application, so when you have to know about the structures that you are storing, if they are not made explicit in the system, and if you can define any constraints of them, it's up to the application, and that's why some of the systems are only appropriate if your data, your structure is simple enough to go.
So, coffee time. Thank you very much.
Also, ist das so? Also, wir haben das nicht.